Ask you something. When you hear the songs in church, do you listen to the words and let them be a blessing to you and strengthen your faith? You know, we listen to music on the radio sometimes, and maybe we listen to music on TV or recordings or something, and just for entertainment. I'm not like some preachers. Some preachers think that if it's not a gospel song, it's sin. I don't think everything it's not gospel is a sin. A lot of it is, but not everything. I still like Marty Robbins' old gunfighter ballads. That's probably just worldliness, I guess. But I like some old cowboy songs, there were just some old folk songs and stuff. So it wasn't anything to do about Christianity, but I liked them. And it's entertainment, but I like the songs at church for the eternal value. It's more than just entertaining you for a few minutes and, you know, lifting your spirits. I even like that one, zippity-doo-da, zippity-yay, what a wonderful feeling, what a wonderful day. You know, it doesn't got anything to do with Christianity. It's just kind of uplifting, but it doesn't do much for eternity, you know. But maybe some of us would be maybe we'd be better off if we sang zippity-doo-da every once in a while. How many of you are morning people and you just love to jump right straight out of bed and clap your hands and say, glory to God, I get to live another day? Did you do that? Or when you get to be Al's age, and you will. You'll be glad to wake up any morning. See, I'm blind on my right side. I can't see anybody over here, so that's why I pick on Al. He's on the left side. Uh-oh, he'll be moving over here, won't you? Oh, goodness. But I love the church music. It gives me something to draw me closer to the Lord and to build my faith. And don't we all need to have our faith built up more? I mean, man alive, I just need more faith. Sometimes I feel like a leaky bucket. Sometimes I'm doing pretty good, you know. I just read something out of Scripture, or maybe prayed a prayer or heard some preaching that just kind of got me lifted up, you know, and I'm doing pretty good. But I leak, and my faith kind of drains out. And so I have to get recharged again. And some of that music does that. And I hope the Word of God does that for you. Open up to Revelation chapter number 4. And we're going to start with verse 1 and 2 again. We left off there last week. We only got a couple of points into our message. And so we're going to, good Lord willing, finish it up tonight. Chapter 4 of Revelation in our series After This. You know, some people think what they're living for right now is all there is. So many Hollywood actors and rock stars and just common, ordinary, everyday people commit suicide. They think, man, if this all there is, I'm going to be out of here. They don't realize they've just opened the door to a whole new world. It might not have been the world they wanted to go to. And this is not all there is. After this, there's something else. After this church age, there's something else. And we're going to find it right here. Look at verse 1 and 2. Now, I'm going to need a couple of fellows to help me tonight. I want to do something different. I'd like to have Aaron as one of my readers in a little while. Aaron, you've got Revelation chapter 6. I've got some verses for you to read. And who else got a good, strong voice? We need somebody on a microphone. We need microphones for everybody. Brother Denny, would you take these two microphones and you don't have to turn them on until we get there. It'll be a while before we get there. Give one to Danny over there. Danny's got a good, strong voice. Singers always got a good voice. We like singers and auctioneers to read. We generally pick singers before auctioneers. They don't go so fast. When we get, Brother Danny, when we get to it, it'll be a few minutes, so it'll be a while, but Matthew chapter 24 is where I want you to keep focused after a while. It'll be probably 15 minutes from now. And Brother Aaron, you're going to do Revelation chapter 6. Y'all are going to read responsively. You know what responsively is, don't you? It means you read a verse and he reads a verse. He reads a verse and you read a verse. You're just going, well, in the hills of Arkansas, it's we're going to take time about. There you go. That's not near as dignified as saying reading responsively, but we know what that means, don't we? Revelation chapter 4 and verse number 1. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was, as it were, a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. Father, as one on the throne, I pray that you would allow us to come into your presence tonight through the reading of thy word and through the preaching. Lord, I pray that you would make this service one that is acceptable to you. And Lord, may we see the specialness of the rapture and the truth of it. And may it lodge in our hearts indelibly tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we entitled the message Up, Up, and Away last week, and we covered the first two points. And you may remember the first point was talking about the positions on the rapture. And there were several different positions that we covered. You got pre-trib rapture, and that's what we are. And then you've got mid-trib rapture. And then you've got pre-wrath rapture. And you've got post-trib rapture. And all of that has to do with how people interpret the scriptures to arrive at a time when they believe the rapture will occur in relation to the rapture or to the tribulation. And then we look, number two, at the picture of the rapture. This chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, we read some quotes by some of the expositors of the past who also agree that they believe that they see this being exemplary of the rapture of the church in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, when the Lord says, come up hither. And that's what he's going to say to the church one of these days. There's going to be a trumpet sound. Brother Noah and I were talking just before church, and he was asking me about the archangels, and one of the archangels, Gabriel, is associated with blowing trumpets. And on that day, when the Lord gets ready to come back, I don't know, it doesn't say, but since Gabriel is associated with trumpet blowing, it may very well be that this one of two special angels, Michael the archangel and Gabriel the archangel, Gabriel rather, is one that's associated with the trumpets, and so maybe he's going to be the one to sound the trumpet, and the Lord's going to say, come up hither, and that'll be a special time for us. Now, let's go right in. We've seen the positions and the picture of the rapture. Let's go into number three and talk about the person of the rapture. The person of the rapture. Jesus is coming personally to take his people, the church, to be with him in heaven. And that's real, and that's exciting. I hope you see how exciting it is. I hope it thrills your heart. I hope you don't think that this is just some far-fetched thing that may or may not happen. It is true. It is biblical. The rapture will happen. That trumpet will sound, and we get to go to be in heaven with him. And there are those who teach that the second coming of Christ is fulfilled. Some people teach that the second coming of Christ is fulfilled at the time a person gets saved. They say the moment you get saved, that's when Jesus comes into your heart, and that's the coming of Christ. Well, now that's going to be a little bit hard to prove from the Scripture. In fact, I've never found in the Bible where it says that Jesus comes into your heart at all. Now, it's true that the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within us, but that's not the second coming. And the Bible's very clear. Look at John 14 with me. John chapter 14. We're going to look at several scriptures tonight. I hope you got your Bible and ready to use it. This is what we... Someday somebody's going to say, hey, why do you believe in that rapture business? And why are you pre-trib rapture? And just what is it going to be like in your belief? And you ought to be able to give an answer for the hope that lies within you. And that's why That's why we're going through this. So we know scripturally why we believe what we say we believe. In John chapter 14, verse 2 and 3, Jesus said this as he was preparing to go back to heaven. He said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." This is a personal coming. And what does he say? He says, "I'm going to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye shall be also." So he's not, it's not coming, he's not coming just to dwell in our hearts. He's coming back to get us where we go where he is. He's not coming here to stay with us. We're going there to stay with him at the second coming. And this is a personal coming. This truth is also taught, turn in the book of Acts, please, to Acts chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. It says, "Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking the things pertaining to the kingdom of God." Now we learn here that right after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, he spent some 40 days walking the earth with his disciples and teaching them things pertaining to the kingdom. And then he assures them that they're going to have the power of God on their ministry. In verse number 8, he says, "You'll be witnesses and the Holy